hoping against hope. And I can't spell. So, bear with me. It's a lot easier when I taught like third graders. Because they didn't know what I was wrong. We draw mostly pictures. So, hoping against hope. So that's what we're going to talk about today. So, let's start off. What do we know about Sarah? We may cover this a little bit more. What do we already know about Sarah?
She's married to Abraham.
Married to Abraham.
She's very old.
Yeah, she's very old.
Like 90-something, 98 or something.
Yep.
When she had...
She was...
Isaac.
She was 90 when she had Isaac.
I'm 90.
Also, sister to Abraham.
Sister to Abraham. That's going to come out today. Which, that got her and Abraham in trouble a couple of times, for sure.
Sister?
They're siblings. They're half-siblings. Same father, different mothers. Tela, I can't pronounce it. T-E-R-A-H.
Tara
was their dad. So, and that's really, there's not a whole lot of scriptures specifically about Sarah. Actually, we don't even know anything about Sarah until she's 65 years old. That's the first time we get introduced to Sarah. And if we jump in there, that is actually in Genesis. My book is a little...
12,
yes. Actually, 11.
11.
Because at the end of 11 it says, verses 29... Abraham and Norah took wives for themselves. The name of Abram's wife was Sarai, and the name of Norm's wife was Milcah, the daughter of, and then blah, 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 blah. Sarai was barren and had no children. So that's the first time we even find out about her. And this is when she's commissioned with Abraham. It's a blessing from God. So, Sarai, do you guys know what Sarai means in the original? You know what that... My princess.
Okay.
Aww. And I completely misspelled that too. This is why I've taken notes sometimes. Should have somebody else write. And Sarah means princess. Kind of a different change in meaning there. From my princess to princess. Being more of an earthly Abraham's princess. To God's prince, so, or princess. So, like I said, doesn't really talk about Sarah prior to the age of 65. Half-sister of Abraham. They had the same father, but they're 10 years apart between the two. Exactly 10 years between Abraham and Sarah. And some people say, well, would they have sinned because they were siblings married? No. Technically, no. Because not until the time of Moses and the Levitical law, if you really want to take notes of that, so it's Leviticus 18, 6 through 18, and Leviticus 20, 17 through 21, is where it specifically says you can't marry your half-sister, your siblings, and stuff like that. That's when they really started diverging. At the time of Abraham and Sarah, they were... six generations behind Noah. So the genetic pool would have been really good and pure still, most likely. So them being married wouldn't have any problems or things along those lines. It wasn't until the time of Moses that that law came into effect. So they technically did not sin because they married as half-siblings. But later on, after Moses' time and all that, they technically would have sinned against the law. So... Some people say, well, they sinned because... No, that was way prior. This is all predecessor. So, they're way before it. And we got an extra drawer. So, kind of some things there. And the first thing we do know is they're in Genesis 11:30. And it says, Sarah was barren and had no children. This would have been up to about the age of 65. Is when... Because right in the following verses in chapter 12 is when Abraham gets his commission from God to leave and go into other nations. At this time, they were living in Ur in Chaldean. I can't speak this morning. Somebody else should have.
Chaldean.
Yes. This would have been a very good city. Very big, wealthy, well-known urban city. So they would have been considered city people, I guess, if you want to look at it that way. They weren't out in the boonies away from anywhere. They were in an area with established rules and regulations and so on. And this was also a pagan culture too. But, like we said earlier, sixth generation down. Abraham was the sixth generation from Seth, Noah's son. So he would have known of Yahweh, the true God. But it also says specifically that he was a pagan. You actually go to Joshua 24:2. Someone want to read that? Joshua 24:2.
Joshua said to all the people, "This is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. Long ago your ancestors, including Terah, the father of Abraham and Nahor, lived beyond the Euphrates River and worshipped other gods."
So they worshipped other gods. Abraham would have worshipped other gods at the time. But in verse 12, or chapter 12 of Genesis, Abraham pulls away from this. And thus, also Sarah pulls away from this, of worshipping other pagan gods. So, now let's go back to Genesis 12. And let's read the promise that God gave to Abraham. This was the first time that God spoke to Abraham and really called him out. So Genesis 12, 1 through 3. Can somebody read that blessing from God? A promise.
1 through what?
1 through 3.
Go ahead, Sam.
The Lord said to Abraham, "Go out from your land, your relatives, and your father's house to the land that I will show you. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse those who treat you with contempt. And all the peoples on earth will be blessed through you."
Thank you, Sam. So let's pull out some key points here. So what's the first thing God tells him to do?
Leave.
Now, who's he supposed to leave behind?
Everybody.
Everybody except
his wife.
His wife, Sarah. So, she would have been tied to this blessing by being with him. So, the next part, what's the kind of the next part of that blessing?
Make him a great nation.
Make him a great nation. How are nations created?
With people.
With people, yeah. You gotta have people to have nations. What specifically? How does a nation grow? Think of the most simple form.
They repopulate.
Repopulate. Well, that normally happens through
reproduction.
Reproduction. Now keep in mind, Sarah's barren, so she's tied to this blessing. And this probably would have been something for her to, I think, see some beauty in, if she really accepted this. You guys think so? What's your opinion on that? How do you see Sarah receiving this part of this blessing from God? Think Abraham's coming back to Sarah, or Abram's coming back to Sarai, if we keep the name at the time, and going, "God just told me to go do this. We're going to go leave our family, run off, and we're going to start a whole nation, just the two of us." How do you think Sarah would have felt about that? 65.
You probably felt like, "Well, I don't want to start all over again."
I can't start all over again.
I can't start all over again. I'm barren. How are we going to make a nation when we don't have any little things running around to make a nation from?
God's timeline and ours are significantly different. But they might look significantly different.
Yes. Do you think so? There's how are we going to do this attitude type thing? But is there another side of that too? You think? If she truly believed in God and had faith in God, wouldn't she also be happy that maybe she would have her womb open to become a mother? I think that was part of it too.
No, and she's probably shunned by the other woman that had children.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. think of it at this time. So you got Abraham and Sarah. So she's 65 at the time. Abram would have been 75. They're living with Abram's family, his brother, relatives, and all that. They're all having children. They're all growing up. 65. So that's possibly grandkids, great-grandkids on Abraham's brother's side. And her tree is just the two of them.
She may have felt like she didn't wouldn't be able to mix in or wouldn't belong. She wasn't contributing like the rest of them.
Yep. But I also see through this blessing, too, that God bestowed upon her, he opened up hope for Sarah. Very much. And Abram could have taken another wife to have another children to. Keep in mind, they come from a pagan culture. It would have been accepted in that pagan culture. But he didn't. He stayed with Sarah, was faithful to Sarah, and Sarah was faithful to him. And that hope was able to be, well,
eventually.
Up to this point of time.
Okay.
We're still in chapter 12. So, but there's some hope here, really.
Well, and didn't they have children older than we do now? We had children when they were really old, in our point of view.
This would have been the very end, though. If you look at biblical stuff for the women, this would have been at the time for almost like a woman of today, the womb of today. Granted that, yes, they did live longer and stuff like that, but normally childbearing was in your first 40, 50 years for sure. Because 50 years would have been a hard... Now, the men, yes, the men did father children, but the women...
Oh, they took younger women.
They took younger brides.
Oh, it's
because Abraham's father, I can't remember the numbers for sure, I read it somewhere, he didn't have Abraham until he was over the age of 100.
So maybe they took young women.
They took young women.
According to what you're saying, they had to take young women. Because the men were still... really old.
Yep, those old geezers.
Or did they age differently before the flood?
Possibly. Well, this one after the flood. This is all post flood.
Yeah, that's
this is six generations away. Because Abraham's dad died when he was 200.
Yeah, that's right.
So he didn't live to be a very, very old man like some of the other ones that were 300, 400, 500 years old. So.
Well, I can see women being worried about that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, going to take another young gal. I can't produce anymore.
Yep.
But if she had hope, a whole movement maybe just might have sprung a feeling of hope in her that, well, maybe God's going to give me a child, something. But just because it's a new adventure, a new idea.
Mm-hmm. And I think that's really comes about. I see God's blessing here upon Abraham also being a sign of hope for Sarah. Is how I see it.
You know, too, probably, and where she was feeling lesser than the women there because she didn't have any children. So going somewhere else where they didn't know her, she would leave that behind, maybe, not have that.
That burden.
Yeah.
Almost kind of walking a clean slate here. So let's keep going on. So then they travel to Egypt. That's the next place they go. So Abraham leaves there, goes to Egypt, and he does the stupid thing in Egypt with Sarah. And he claims that he's only a brother. It's not a lie, but it's not the full truth either. Now keep in mind, she's 65 years old, and she's extremely beautiful. I've often wondered if this beauty was physical only or physical and relational. Does that make sense? What do you guys think?
Well, I think there's probably physical attraction, physical beauty there.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, line 11 says, "Here now, I know that you are a good-looking woman." So, I mean, it's physical. It doesn't say anything about her mind, but...
Yeah.
It could have been.
It could have been. There's some things here, because some women are found beautiful by the way they interact with other people. Not just only their physical appearance, per se. So, and I'm not saying that was the case here with Pharaoh and his officials recognizing that, but I think that's part of it too, was maybe how she interacted with Abraham, that, hey, there's could have been something else here. And Abraham's treated very well. He's given a lot of sheep, oxen, donkeys, male and female servants, and female donkeys and camels. This would have been kind of like a, oh, I forget the term when you I don't want to say purchase your bride, but
dowry.
A dowry. Some people view this as maybe Pharaoh was kind of doing a little bit of a dowry here to Abraham. Dad's not in the picture, not around, so next person to get it would be the brother. So that's kind of the thought there. And he takes the stuff. But then once he finds out that, hey, Abraham is actually Sarah's husband, off you go. And he takes all this stuff with him. This is where Hagar comes from. Prior to this, because she was an Egyptian. She came from Pharaoh's blessing upon Abraham through this time. So. Sorry, I'm going to figure out where I am in my notes. So that's kind of the things that go in there. Now, the next time we run into Sarah, we have the whole thing with Pharaoh. They leave there. She's considered a very beautiful woman. You have Abraham, the lot and all that, and then the War of the Kings, some other things there. And then also, you have Melchizedek who comes in, and this is where we can really see that Abraham recognized God as being the true God. Melchizedek would have been from a line. We actually don't know exactly where Melchizedek came from for his priestly line, but it would have been a God-fearing line, a Yahweh line. And Abraham recognized that, and thus Sarah does also too, and receives a blessing and portion there too. And then again, in chapter 15, we see that where Abraham is promised a son. Now, this is another thing. Could have been a great hope for Sarah, or a very burden aspect to this. Kind of a double sword here, probably for Sarah and how she felt about this. She would have been around the age of 75 now, and having no children. So what's the next best thing she can do in her mind?
Have a substitute.
Substitute. So in her mind, she goes, well, I own Hagar. She's my servant. She's my slave. So if Abraham has a wife or has a child through Hagar, technically I own the child because it's from Hagar. That's the logic here. Not very good logic in the scheme of it. This is where things really break down. And you guys kind of know how the story falls out from here. The sad part is Abraham would have probably said, Sarah, no, let's have faith in God to open your womb. I think things would have been completely different. But Sarah, trying to fulfill the promise that God gave to Abraham, takes the place of God's role and screws everything up on this side. If you look at the Middle East, this whole thing was all created because of this one family incident right here.
But Abraham went along with it.
He was not a very good husband at this point. And we talked about that last week with Adam and Eve and how that was probably not some very good things that Adam did there too. Abraham slipped here. He definitely slipped and fell short.
Making men look bad.
When monogamy in a relationship is broken, it always causes confusion. And that's what happened here. At no time in history has there ever been a monogamous relationship that has broken outside of that to polygamy, or to plural loving aspects. Has there any been good of it? Think about it. You got David with Bathsheba. David's son from Bathsheba was Solomon. Even though he was a very wise man, he had a kingdom fall because of it. You look at any relationship down the road, that's always been the case. And Abraham should have stopped it right here.
So is this about the father's sins are visited on the sons? Is that what you're saying?
I don't know if that would have been a true statement here.
I mean, it sounds like you're carrying it over to the son.
From David to Solomon, it might have been a little bit. Because I think that more has to do with how a son sees his father interact, and thus what the son thinks is right to do.
Okay.
So.
Yeah, okay.
But, guys, any questions, comments?
Well, I think it was interesting you mentioned that Abraham was only six generations away from
Seth, which was Noah.
Yeah.
Noah's son, yep.
Okay, and yet they moved to a very large city, okay? In six generations, it's amazing that there could have been that many people generating, well, everything, you know, basically having offspring. I guess some of them had lots and lots of children, and they just all spread out. And
yep.
They just multiplied, kind of like rabbits is what it sounds
like. It kind of sounds like rabbits or rats, however you want to view it.
If you figure that you're 100 plus years old, though, that's a long generation compared to what we think of a generation
sure.
now.
Yeah.
Yep.
200 years, that's a long generation.
Sorry, ninth generation, descended from Seth. I was wrong there on my statement, sorry.
Was Seth one of Adam and Eve's children? Was it he?
Seth was Noah's three sons.
That's right. But he was also Adam and Eve.
He was Adam and Eve's, yes.
They had a son named Seth.
Yep. Because you have, if you go back, you have the flood, and then right after the flood, you have the Tower of Babel. And then right after the Tower of Babel, you have the descendants of Seth, and Abraham comes out of that. So the world would have been confused at this time with all the different languages, and God divided them at the Tower of Babel. They're going out, they're spreading like rats and bunnies, and creating all these cities and establishments and everything.
Well, if you could build a tower even back then, it told you the technology and the abilities, so.
Yeah. They're doing a lot. So at the age of basically 75, Sarah takes on part of her role as God and gives Hagar to have a child with Abraham. Abraham accepts it and moves on. And this whole idea of one flesh that God created at the very beginning of time is now broken between Abraham and Sarah. So, and that's back in Genesis 16:3 is where that takes place when Sarah gives a Hagar to him. It says, after Abraham had lived 10 years in the land of Canaan, Abram's wife Sarai took Hagar the Egyptian, her maid, and gave her to her husband Abraham as his wife. So, Abraham didn't refrain from it. It says, disobedience, this is kind of a quote out of John MacArthur's book. It says, disobedience to that standard has always resulted in evil consequences when you break down those forms of marriage. If you read on, Genesis 16, 5 through 6, does someone want to read that, please? Genesis 16, 5 through 6.
Sarai said to Abram, this outrage being done to me is your fault. True, I gave my slave girl to you to sleep with, but when she saw that she was pregnant, she began holding me in contempt. May Adonai decide who is right, I or you. Through 5, right?
Through 6.
6. Right. However, Avram answered Sarai, look, she's your slave girl. Deal with her as you think fit. Then Sarai treated her so harshly that she ran away from her.
Talk about a spousal dispute. I bet that was one hot tent that night when they found out that Hagar was pregnant.
But that's what she wanted.
Wasn't that? Yeah.
That's what she wanted. But the moment she got it.
It was Hagar's attitude that she didn't like.
Well, I think there was probably also a little bit of she didn't.
Jealousy.
A little bit of jealousy there.
Yeah. Be so careful what you ask for, you might get it.
Yep.
Because if she asked for it, then was sorry.
Yep.
And just he Hagar going, I'm pregnant, you're not.
Yep. So definitely bad. Bad scenario going on here. And Hagar runs away, an angel appears to her and says, no, go back and live with them. So Hagar goes back and lives with them, and she actually gets the blessing from the angel through from God, saying that your child will be the father of many nations. Keep in mind, up to this point, Sarah officially hasn't been given it. It's been given to Abraham, but it hasn't been given to Sarah. But now it's been given to Hagar, the Egyptian servant. I think that's kind of a little interesting, personally. So, and that's in verse 10 there. It says, moreover, the angel of the Lord said to her, I will greatly multiply your descendants so that they will be too many to count. The angel of the Lord blessed her. Sarah basically goes here from the age of 65 on in silence. Keep in mind, Ishmael's born when Sarai is about 76. And they live in Canaan for about 24 years before Sarah ever becomes pregnant. So here's 10 years in. We got another 13 to go, because it'd be a year after this is when Ishmael would be born. And so Sarah would have been 89 the next time Abraham got the message that God would have Sarai have a child. Let's jump forward to chapter 17, verses 15 through 22.
See, I was just wondering, it was just a maybe random thought, I just never noticed that before. Is this of sorts because she was a Egyptian that was a slave? This is a foreshadowing what was coming in the future.
And there's a lot of commentaries also on that. And then there's also another aspect here between Sarai and Hagar. Hagar being the works of man to try to fill to God's will, or Sarah being the grace of God filling God's will. So there's two sides here too. Scripture talks about that in the New Testament elsewhere, and he actually compares these two women to each other. So, but I don't think we had time today to hit on that, so I didn't prepare a whole lot of that. But yes, there is a difference here between the two. So let's go back to Genesis 17. 15 through 22. Someone want to grab that? Have a longer one.
And God said to Abraham, as for you, Sarai, your wife, you shall not call her name Sarai, but Sarah shall be her name. I will bless her, and indeed I will give you a son by her. Then I will bless her, and she shall be a mother of nations. Kings of people will come from her. Then Abraham fell on his face and laughed and said in his heart, will a child be born to a man 100 years old? And will Sarah, who is 90 years old, bear a child? And Abraham said to God, oh, that Ishmael might live before you. But God said, no, but Sarah, your wife, will bear you a son, and you shall call his name Isaac, and I will establish my covenant with him for an everlasting covenant for his descendants after him. As for Ishmael, I have heard you. Behold, I will bless him and will make him fruitful and will multiply him exceedingly. He shall become the father of 12 princes, and I will make him a great nation. But my covenant I will establish with Isaac, whom Sarah will bear to you at this season next year. When he finished talking with him, God went up from Abraham.
So here you got news from God, if you're Abraham. And you run to your wife, saying, you're going to get pregnant. You're going to have a child. Normally, it's the other way in today's culture. Normally, the wife finds out she's pregnant before the husband does. Could you imagine this interaction? How do you think this would feel, this tense conversation? How do you think they had the conversation here? How do you think Abraham would have presented to Sarah? And how do you think Sarah would have received it?
She probably laughed. If she laughed at God, yeah. She probably laughed at him.
Probably did. Be like, you old crazy coot.
Get on out of here.
I already gave you a child. Now you're saying I'm going to get pregnant at the age of 90 and give birth? You've been drinking some wine somewhere you should not have been.
I just looked the meaning up too. The Hebrew of Sarah is actually noble woman.
noble woman.
So she went from princess to noble woman. That's a pretty significant jump.
Yeah. Very significant.
And said it before it actually even happened. So that's kind of, that's the cool thing.
Can you also see the hope here in Sarah really starting to shine again? Keep in mind, Ishmael would have been probably 12 years old at this time. So for 13 years, she has seen Hagar be pregnant, give birth, Abraham enjoying a relationship with Ishmael as a father-son relationship, and Sarah sitting here being quiet, having to watch all this.
See the inside, probably.
Seeing the inside, yeah. This
seething.
One,
angry.
Soothing, yeah, I think.
Seething.
Seething, yes.
Regretting.
Or there's a side here where maybe she's sitting back and going, I messed up, God, I just be in control. Yeah. Sometimes time heals that.
Maybe that's how she got pregnant. Maybe that's when God decided to give her a child, because she maybe repented or asked forgiveness or something. I don't know.
We don't know the details for sure on that or what's going on, but we do know God said, yep, she's going to have a child. Note to self, write notes out from now on. It always goes up to the very top of where my lines were. So I have to scroll way back down and find where I was.
Are you set to get a tablet with bigger words?
That costs money. Da, 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 da. So the promise is fulfilled of what was stated earlier, of her being able to become a great nation. Now let's go into Genesis 18, 1 through 8.
I wonder, excuse me for
interrupting.
Yep. I wonder if he told Sarah that Ishmael would be the father of many nations. I wonder if he told her that part.
I bet he did.
So that means he's got a jump on her, and that made it probably worse for her.
It could have, but then the other part of it down here too is the blessing part. Verse 21 says, but my covenant I established will be with Isaac, whom Sarah will bear to you at the season next year.
Yeah. I hope he told her that too.
Yeah, I hope he did. But I bet he did. Let's go into chapter 18, verses 1 through 8. Will someone want to read that, please?
Then the Lord appeared to Abraham at the oaks of Mamre while he was sitting in the entrance of his tent during the heat of the day. And he looked up and saw three men standing near him. When he saw them, he ran from the entrance of the tent to meet them and bowed to the ground. Then he said, my Lord, if I have found favor in your sight, please do not go on past your servant. Three verses? Then he said, my Lord, if I have found favor in your sight, please, I'll just read that. Let a little water be brought that ye may wash your feet and rest yourselves under the tree. I will bring a bit of bread so that you can strengthen yourself. This is why you have passed your servant's way. Later you will continue on. Yes, they replied, do as you have said. So Abraham hurried to the tent and said to Sarah, quick, knead three measures of fine flour and make bread. Meanwhile, Abraham ran to the herd and got a tender choice calf. Gave it to a young man who hurried to prepare it. Then Abraham took herbs and milk and the calf that he had prepared and set them before the men. He served them as they ate under the tree.
So what was Sarah's role through all this? When the two guys come and visit, Abraham sees them. He says, why don't you just stay for a little bread and a little bit of water to drink? But instead, he makes this huge feast. And what is Sarah's part of this?
Cook the bread, get together.
Make the body.
Interesting, make the body of bread. There's a significant part here of also recognizing Sarah's relationship to Abraham. In 1 Peter 3, 5 through 6, it talks about Sarah's willingness to still serve Abraham. And how she's willing to actually serve him as her husband. and do stuff. And she's held up as a model of, to wives of today. Peter does that. Her willingness. Now keep in mind, she's not young. She's 89 years old. She could have passed it on to her servant and been like, hey, just go make some bread for Abraham. I'm going to enjoy the shade tree. But she had a willingness to still serve her husband in the even her old age. Now, the promise is again backed up and stuff, and so, and then we get to read the interaction between the two men, verses 9 and on. Then they said to him, where is Sarah, your wife? And he said, here in the tent. That meant she was somewhere in the tent within earshot. Somewhere where she could hear the conversation. He said, I will surely return to you at this time next year, and behold, Sarah, your wife, will have a son. And Sarah was listening at the tent door, which was behind him. Now, Abraham and Sarah were old. Keep in mind, 89, 99 at this time. Sarah, now Abraham were old, advanced in age, and Sarah was past childbearing. Sarah laughed to herself, saying, after I have become old, shall I have pleasure, my Lord being old also? And the Lord said to Abraham, why did Sarah laugh, saying, shall I indeed bear a child when I am so old? Is anything too difficult for the Lord? At the appointed time, I will return to you at this time next year, and Sarah will have a son. Sarah deemed it, however, saying, I did not laugh, for she was afraid. And he said to her, no, but you did laugh. What do you think the emotion behind Sarah's laughing here was?
Like, really?
Like, huh?
Seriously?
So, do you think that one of these three men, were they angels, or were that actually the Lord that came and told Abraham about him having a son? Because he called him Lord. He said, my Lord. I mean, he made a big deal out when these guys came. I wonder if he recognized him as an angel, right, or as the Lord.
There's some people that have concluded that, yes, this would have been like a Lord present type thing.
Not a reincarnated,
but a pre-incarnated form of Jesus.
It says Jehovah.
Jehovah.
It does, so.
Yeah. And MacArthur actually points that out, too, that it's... So, yes, you can. And it also shows how, as the progression, you look at the very beginning... with Abraham talking to God, is kind of a distance thing when he says you're going to be a great nation, people are going to bless you. And it's being refined down very much here. God and Abraham are having a more and more intimate relationship as things are going on to this point right here where...
So he's expecting that to be the Lord. Then.
Well, that's why he knew it was. Because he said he was a friend of God. He's credited as that, so obviously he must have had a relationship. He's like, Oh, it's you.
It's you. I recognize you from a ways away. Make a meal. Hey. Have a feast.
Maybe they were glad someone was coming along, but these guys he was really glad.
Yes, very glad. I think that Sarah, though, with her laughing here, would have been a little bit of excitement, joy, fear. People laugh when they, and the fearing of her denying it was a part of that, too. Sadly, right after this, they do the whole brother-sister thing again with Abimelech, the king. And Abraham claims Sarah as being the sister again. And Abimelech has a vision, basically, and kicks Abraham and Sarah out again with a lot of goods and stuff again. So, and right after that, Sarah comes with child. You have this whole thing all the way up from basically chapter 16, where we started, up to chapter 21, verses 1 through 8, when Isaac is born. So we've been building, crescendoing all this way up until Isaac's birth of chapter 21, 1 through 8. Then the Lord took note on Sarah, as he had said, and the Lord did to Sarah what he had promised. That's key there. God's promise always will happen, no matter the timing of your life. If God promises you to do something, it will take place no matter where you are in life. No matter what you think your earthly situation is. Keep in mind, Sarah's earthly situation, she thought she was barren. She thought she was over childbearing age. She's got a double strike against her from ever having children. And yet God's timing was perfect through his promise.
You think like God might have waited just to show that it was him that did it? That's the only way.
I think so. I think there's a little bit of proving to everybody here. This is from God. This isn't from anybody else. This is from God. Kind of like Mary having Jesus. Mary being a virgin. It was from God, definitely thing. And I think this was kind of the same line, except Abraham being the seed of that. This is from God that Abraham would have a wife with, or have a child with his wife, Sarah, and thus signs it. So she conceived and bore a son to Abraham in his old age, at the anointed time of which God had spoken to him. Abraham called the name of his son, who was born to him, whom Sarah bore him, Isaac. Then Abraham circumcised his son Isaac when he was 8 years old, 8 days old, as God had commanded him. Now Abraham was 100 years old when his son Isaac was born to him. Sarah would have been 90. She's 10 years apart. Sarah said, God has made laughter for me. Whenever whoever will hear will laugh at me. And she said, who would have said to Abraham that Sarah would nurse a child, yet I have borne him a son in his old age. And the child grew and was weaned, and Abraham made a great feast on that day when Isaac was weaned. Talk about a hope fulfilled. Last week we talked about how Eve's curse in the garden was also her blessing. It's kind of the same here with Sarah. Sarah's curse of being childbarren was her blessing when God opened her womb and gave her a child so that she could play and laugh with at the age of 90 years old. And everybody who hears it will laugh at it too.
It's sort of like when something awful happens to you and then later on it turns out to be something good. If that hadn't happened, this would, good thing wouldn't have happened. It's like curse to blessing.
Yep, the promise from God wouldn't have been able to come through.
But at the time, it doesn't look like it's going to be that way. And then later on, it turns out to be a good thing.
Yep.
Had we been in charge.
Keep in mind, this all started when Sarah was 65 years old. She is now 90. That's 25 years gap here for God's promise to be fulfilled and stuff. And I think this is where her greatest beauty wasn't exactly physical, but was also faithfulness to God.
Yeah.
I think that's pointed out. Yeah. So that's kind of where we're already over time. I'm bad at running over time on this stuff. So, and Peter talks about this a lot more in 1 Peter, if you want to read more about it, 1 Peter 3:6. Let's talk about how Abraham or Sarah is definitely a role model of today's women. So can I get somebody to close us off in prayer? If you don't mind.